Welcome to EJIL Live. In our most recent issue, 26-4, we've published an article entitled Humanity Considerations Cannot Reduce War's Hazards Alone, Revitalizing the Concept of Military Necessity. And I have with me the author, Professor Yishai Beer, who is a professor at the Radzyner School of Law in Herzliya, Israel. Welcome, Yishai.
Thank you.
As you would expect, it's an article that's bound to create some reaction, hopefully some controversy. And the basic proposition from which you start is that there is an artificial tension in the essential conception of international humanitarian law between military necessity and considerations and humanity. And you say that in some respects it's a false dichotomy. So maybe let's start by explaining this basic proposition.
Indeed. If you open a textbook dealing with the law of armed conflict, usually we'll find at the very beginning some kind of presentation of two polar opposites of principles. On the one spectrum, on the one edge of the spectrum, you have the necessity principle, and on the other hand, you have the humanity principle. And the assumption, usually the explicit assumption, is that a la guerre comme a la guerre, all is fair in war. The assumption is that soldiers are murderer, brutal, or it seems to be that soldiers are potential murderer, or potential rapists.
Or at least they kill.
Yeah, they kill. But by definition, they're almost like criminals. And only the law and the humanitarian camp is the one who can stop them. And I think such a presentation is a false one. Because military professionalism requires or has its own inherent constraining elements of brutality. A professional soldier has to exercise force, but in an exact dose, in professional dose. It doesn't have to be too brutal.
And you say that the professional soldier has to exercise force in an exact dose, and he need not or he should not be brutal. This is not because of considerations of humanity, but it comes from the very professionalism of being a soldier.
Yes, utilitarian consideration per se.
Utilitarian consideration
per se. You know, one of the principles of war, one most important principle of war, which is common to many militaries, which I'm familiar with, not only Western liberals' militaries, but also Russian military, is the economy of force. You don't waste ammunition. It's a matter of economy.
So now translate this basic proposition that military professionalism alone can act on a constraint on brutal use of force. Give me some examples that will illustrate this.
The most important issue is of targeting. You know, 2,000 years ago, Sun Tzu wrote that the best generals don't have to fight. They just maneuver. When it comes to targeting, if you have to kill, but only those who are necessary for achieving your mission. You don't have to kill everyone in the battlefield. For example, the current paradigm in the law of armed conflict is, for example, that all combatants are fair game. I even may say fair prey. But this is a false assumption from a professional point of view. You don't have to kill all of your enemy in order to win a war. You know, 150 years ago in the St. Petersburg Declaration, it has been said that your aim in a war should be to weaken your enemy. And that's absolutely right. You don't have to kill everyone in your adversary military in order to win a war.
I have a fundamental question I want to ask you, but before I get to that, how does this proposition that the professionalism of armies can restrict brutality apply when it comes to collateral damage of civilians? Isn't it, if you don't have to worry about collateral damage of civilians, doesn't it make it easier for the general to manage his or her battlefield?
To some extent it does, but on the other hand, you know, it creates a lot of other problems which are inherent to war. When it comes to collateral damage, usually we look when we look at the equation of the collateral damage, we look at the humanitarian suffering side of the civilians. I'm calling to look at the military advantage side of the equation and to define properly the military advantage. So if you limit your military advantage list, you reduce substantially the issue of collateral damage. And you know, you don't have a military advantage of having many of your adversary civilians being killed or injured. You don't have any military advantage in that. I can see a counter effect to that.
We used to hearing from example from at least the way it gets translated into layman's terms that American military doctrine is the use of overwhelming force so as to reach a decisive victory in the shortest amount of time. Doesn't that run against at least the second proposition of limiting collateral damage? It's true, you don't need it in order to win your war, but if you use overwhelming force in order to reach a decisive victory in the battlefield as soon as possible, wouldn't it by necessity, excuse the pun, result in heightened collateral damage?
You know, this is a Colin Powell strategy.
Yes.
A decisive force. It was exerted in the first Iraqi war, in the first Gulf War. But the very same Colin Powell was the one who stopped the war after 100 hours. Because what he did say is that you don't apply proportionality in war. That's a different issue for our discussion, which is very interesting. You know, in the most academics do write or do believe that there is proportionality in war. I mean, ad bellum proportionality that continues throughout the belligerency itself. This doesn't make sense from a military perspective, and Colin Powell doctrine says it precisely. If you want to win, win, and the best way to win is by concentrating your forces and overwhelming force. So this makes sense, but on the other hand, do only the necessities of the war, namely reduce the collateral damage and the damage to combatants. So it was the same Colin Powell who was the main advocate for such an American strategy, who stopped the war very early, at its very early stage, because it said it is not necessary anymore.
And do you
too? We have got enough of the killing.
Do you too subscribe to the view that there is no requirement of ad bellum proportionality?
What I'm saying in fact, is that you have to have ad bellum and in bellum necessity rather than ad bellum proportionality. That's the essence of this paper. And because ad bellum proportionality is what we continue throughout the war. From a strategic point of view, it doesn't make sense. This is exactly the Colin Powell strategy.
So that our readers understand the basic claim, and then, of course, they will study the article. You say that if you really apply this principle of military necessity in a serious way, it will have a similar effect to proportionality. You won't kill civilians if it's unnecessary. You won't use brutal or excessive force if it's unnecessary, because it militates against the professional dimension of managing a war.
Exactly, and that's its main advantage. I mean, it's applicable in war. You can sell it to militaries. What I'm trying to say is that I have an idea that you can sell it to militaries. You cannot sell it to militaries, you cannot convince them to act proportionality when they fight, because, you know, the notion of concentrating power and concentration of mass in order to win a war, it's a basic strategic concept of any war.
So now, the way you framed it a minute ago pushes me to the following question. You say your theory that if you concentrate on the professional aspect of managing a war and you only exercise necessary force in order to reach your objective, whether it's the overall objective of winning the war or more limited objectives of winning this battle or that battle, it will have the similar constraining power on brutality, on collateral damage that are typically associated with humanitarian consideration. But then you said, I need to sell it to militaries. So what is the legal status of your thesis? Is it lex lata or is it some de lege ferenda, something that one would hope to see come in, but until it comes in, we still rely on the classical balance between necessity and humanitarian considerations such as proportionality, collateral damage, etc.
To some extent, it can be both. I mean, it can use as an interpretive tool for applying current norms and standards. And it also has some normative suggestion within it. I mean, the notion that currently there is a distortion, that you pull all of the weight of the constraining force upon the humanitarian consideration, you just look at the reality. Look what happened to civilians in wartime, currently in contemporary wars. So the, when it comes to civilians, the record is very problematic. That's an understatement. Some people will tell you that's a failure. And what about combatants as well? Currently there are...
So here you are making a utilitarian argument. Tell me if I understand you correctly. You're saying that the current paradigm might look good on paper, but in the prosecution of wars, if they can, they follow it. If they can't, they can't follow it. And then they will worry later whether or not they will be prosecuted, ended up in The Hague, etc. Whereas, if I understand you correctly, you say you are better going to achieve the objectives of the humanitarian law of armed conflict if you persuade the generals that simply by fighting professionally, they will be more successful and the humanitarian result would not be essentially different. Is that a good summary?
Yeah, it is indeed. I'm not calling to abolish the humanitarian consideration, but...
I was hoping you would say that.
No, what I'm saying is that let's put most of the weight of the humanitarian consideration upon the necessity principle, and then only the residual powers request upon the humanitarian consideration.
So let me take... I want to talk about one aspect which is very hot in discussions of humanitarian law and armed conflict, especially in the context, for example, of use of force by NATO, for example, in Kosovo and other incidents, and also the current practice of some of the big powers. We see the Russia in Syria in a negative way. We see the United States in Syria. They don't like to put boots on the ground because they try to minimize the casualties to their own soldiers, and therefore bombing takes place from high altitude. They don't want to risk their pilots. Now, it would seem to me that in terms of professionalism and rationalism, it's not unprofessional and it's not irrational for the generals to say we want to limit the casualties to our own armies, and therefore we might not put boots on the ground, therefore we might engage in high-altitude bombing, inevitably having a humanitarian consequence in terms, for example, of collateral damage. How does your theory fit into... And then there's a big debate.
Yeah, of course.
To what extent the loss of your own soldiers can or should or might be balanced against proportionality, collateral damage, etc. How does your theory fit into that specific debate?
Yeah. One of the side effects of my suggestion is that if we shall take the committee established after the Kosovo campaign, and the committee that have checked the, and I quote, the NATO air commanders due to their high latitude bombing practice. But frankly speaking, they were instructed by President Clinton and by the civilian echelon of NATO not to take risks. So rather than checking or examining the NATO air commanders, with all due respect, should be checked after such a campaign, it was President Clinton who should be checked, namely his instruction. If one of the side effects of my suggestion, if the professional standards will be codified as part of the law of armed conflict in the next commission, we shall have to check the instruction of the civilian echelon who instructed the military not to take risks. And so, by the way, you are absolutely right. I mean, under current prevailing law, it's an open question, and there is no mandatory request upon soldiers to take risks upon themselves.
But what is, may I ask you, what is your position on that? It doesn't necessarily follow the way I read your article, that you take the view that it would always be legitimate for a general to take all means available to him or her to limit casualties to their own side, even at the expense, for example, of extensive collateral damage. Would your view be that one in some instances has to take risks and contemplate a higher level of casualties in order to limit collateral damage.
Absolutely right. Currently, it's a moral issue. I prefer to see it as a legal issue. I mean, as a legal...
And you would come down on the side, which is complicated politically, on the side, for example, for Clinton, it would have been complicated politically. For Obama in Syria, it might be complicated politically, by saying to comply, to be professional, as well as to comply with humanitarian law, it means that sometimes you have to put your soldiers in harm's way in order to limit, constrain, minimize collateral damage to civilians.
Absolutely right. And I have a very good example, American example, of the coin doctrine. Counterinsurgents in Afghanistan. The Americans have discovered, after many, many casualties, that Marines don't have only to distract, but they have to build as well. I mean, sometimes the more force you use, it will have a counter effect. It will trigger a counter effect. So that means that, in essence, professionalism means that you have to take risks, of course.
So now I want to step one step backwards and to try and conceptualize or theorize your theory beyond, and say that it seems to me that it's applying rational choice theory in some ways to the way we think about the conduct of hostilities, the use of force, armed conflict, etc. And if that is so, it might have some of the difficulties of rational choice theory, that so often we see that rational choice theory breaks up because people act irrationally at all kinds of levels. So that the question is, even if your construct at some logical level makes sense, wouldn't it be likely that in situations of armed conflict, of armies which are more or less professional, etc., even though it might yield the results, it would be difficult to follow because it's easier just to revert to the old ways of overwhelming force, don't worry about casualties of the enemy, either soldiers or civilians, just get in there, win the war.
Of course there is such a risk, but what I'm trying to argue is that it is indeed the phenomenon that you will see everywhere when you look at wars, contemporary wars and earlier wars, you see extra brutality. But what I'm trying to say is that you have to analyze where does it come from. And the answer that I'm suggesting is that it comes from external forces, such as religious, cultural, psychological, political. I mean, whenever you see too much force used, too many casualties, it comes not from inside, internal vectors from a military perspective, but rather from an external one. So you see extra brutality everywhere. But you know, militaries can act also like a terrorist organization. So they have dual capacities, one of a military, which is objective-oriented, and the other one has some external forces.
Does your thesis argue then in the debate that exists in many places around the world? For example, in Europe, for the most part, the trend in recent years was to abolish compulsory conscription, to have entirely voluntary and professional armies. Is that a development that is consistent with your view presented in the paper, that the more professional the army you have, the more likely you are to have the kind of beneficial results that you see by a rational deployment of force? Whereas if you have more popular armies, it might be more difficult to reach that kind of professionalism?
To some extent it does, because a professional army is more disciplined. I mean, it has its own incentive to discipline its own soldiers. So when you have a mandatory service, people come for 1 or 2 years. And the best example is, of course, the mass army's phenomenon of Napoleon. So when you bring thousands or millions of soldiers to the battlefront, they are a cheap commodity. When you are professional and you have a very selective group, and you discipline them along the years, it has a better chance of achieving my suggested criteria of professionalism.
When you study the origin of the law, the humanitarian law on conflict, you often find that one of the strongest driving forces in it was the notion of honor, that it's dishonorable for a combatant to act in a certain way. In other words, the original protection of civilians under the rules of chivalry was it was unchivalrous for a knight to harm, to kill somebody who was not armed, who was not a combatant. Do you see any place for that kind of honor to be part of the paradigm of professionalism that you are advocating?
Of course it is. It has a lot of room because, you know, soldiers have a code of ethics as well. I mean,
They meant to,
yeah. So, but it leaves you with a wide margin of discretion for soldiers per se and militaries as an organization that would place a lot of weight upon moral issues related to soldiers. And they are moral human beings. So you can ask them also from their moral perspective to save adversary sides. But I'm talking about the minimal threshold, which is the legal one. But of course, there is a lot of room for ethical space between the minimal threshold required by law and the ethical moral principles of every military.
So in a way, here is one way that I could, in some ways, and maybe that's your intention, remove the sting from your article. Because you're saying, I'm not attempting to change the humanitarian law of non-conflict. I'm simply aware of its limitation in the application because all too often it doesn't get applied. And if we started paying attention to rational issues of professional deployment of force, what is the force that is necessary in order to achieve your objective? It's a pity to use more force. It doesn't help you, you waste money, you risk your own soldiers, you kill unnecessarily civilians, you might better achieve the objectives of the humanitarian law of armed conflict. So it's a kind of resurrection of professionalism as an aid to the objectives of the humanitarian law of armed conflict and not what might one might have had the impression that you're saying, forget about the tree huggers, it's the professional soldier where from whom we will seek salvation.
I think you said it's correct. You said it very correctly. So you, in fact, you did it better than I did. What I'm trying to say is that in order to have a better performance, better achievement for the humanitarian issues related to war, you have to put more weight upon the professional standards of the soldiers. Don't give them too easy clemency for moral obligation and humanitarian obligation. And, you know, besides, it's against the intuition of any lawyer. You know, I wrote in a paper a very provocative example. Under administrative law, anyone who has authority, who has force, is in charge of constraining his force. You know, every truck driver is in charge of both the accelerator pedal and the brake pedal. Only when it comes to war, it's up to the lawyer to stop the atrocities. Where does it come from? First of all, the soldiers who apply the force are in charge of both pedals, also the brake pedals. They have to constrain their forces. And only above that, you have the NGOs and humanitarian camp, which has a lot to do in a wartime. But the
so
job is basically...
We use soldiers in a very broad way, but in fact, from your comments earlier and from what you write in the paper, it's not only soldiers, it's even more so their officers and generals. And not even only them, also the civilian authorities.
Of course.
Because it's the civilian authorities that, after all, in our democracies, give guidance to the armies and to the forces, define their objective, define their constraints, etc. So would you, under this view, have problems with a no-boots-on-the-ground, high-altitude bombing instruction from the civilian authorities?
I do have a problem, and I write in the papers that... leaders should be in the game. Namely, one of the side effects of my suggestion is that to impose liability upon civilian leaders who instruct the militaries related to the in bello issues of their military. Currently, you know, when you look at leaders' responsibilities, the ad bellum aggression is not a crime, not yet. Indeed, there is a Kampala development, but under current law, there is no crime of aggression. So when you look at leaders in wartime, they are already exempt, almost exempt, from any obligation related to war. What I am trying to suggest that when you, if you oblige them, if they will be obligated by the professional standards of the military, they will have to reduce the fire, to have, they have to reduce the scope of the war, because they have to be obliged by professional standards. And you have to remember that political, especially a political leader, especially in Western liberal democracies, are under current pressure to stop atrocities, to stop terror, to stop whatever is being perceived as damaging the, your own security. So under such pressure, they're willing to bend, in a sense that they instruct the military not to risk themselves, not to take casualties. They want to be on the safe side. That's a political effect of the current reality. And what I'm trying to say is that we have to bring the political leaders to the equations. They should be responsible and accountable for their in-bello activities of their own militaries. That is one of the side effects of my suggestion.
So my last question, but since so many instances of the use of force today are not classical wars of self-defense, but in fact the call of very often international forces of this type or another, various coalitions, to intervene in a situation to prevent a humanitarian disaster, the higher the risk to their own armed forces, to their own soldiers, the less political will they might have to engage in that kind of humanitarian mission which involves use of force. Isn't there a risk of, by that kind of responsabilization, to actually reduce the willingness to intervene in situation which, for example, could help prevent a genocide or mass humanitarian violation?
Frankly speaking, the issue of humanitarian intervention is very problematic per se, and one has to look at Syria currently in order to see it in real time. But you are right. But you are right. It might prevent leaders from taking risks. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's a matter of distribution of risks. Who has to take the risk? Your own soldiers or the innocent civilians of the adversary? In Kosovo, it has been decided that the local residents, which are totally innocent, will take the risk. And this is not fair.
That's a good point in which to end. I'm sure this discussion will have provoked many of our readers to go and take a very hard look at a provocative article, which ends on that note, responsabilization of political leaders, and the innocent civilians on the other side should not bear the risk, even if it means more casualties to the soldiers of the army using legitimate force. Thank you very much, Professor Beer.
Thank you very much.
Thank you to our viewers.
Thank you.